Hello and thanks for watching. My name is Angel Vilar and I am a network and security engineer at VMware. This is the fourth video of the series Security at Your Service. On the first one we have already seen an introduction to the NSX security model and the distributed firewall. On the second one we have seen how to apply micro-segmentation inside one data center. On the third video we have seen how to extend that micro-segmentation concept across data centers. On this video we will focus on how to achieve network and security automation using external automation tools, and on the last video we will see a bit of the monitoring and visibility you get with NSX. So let's focus on the topic for this video, VMware NSX and automation. NSX by itself is a way of automating network and security deployments because from the central console and with just a few clicks you can create new networks, create new security policies and have them applied almost immediately in all your infrastructure. NSX also exposes REST APIs, which are publicly documented and that can be consumed with your favorite REST client. If you prefer to use Python as your programming language, you can go to GitHub and there you will find that there is a Python-based library to control NSX. Also in GitHub, you can find a RAML specification file describing the NSX APIs, as well as a RAML client that takes the file as an input and composes the API call needed. If you prefer PowerShell as the tool for creating your automation scripts, there are also PowerShell extensions for NSX available that can be downloaded and used. You can also leverage some other automation tools like the VMware vRealize Orchestrator, which provides easy-to-use plugins that simplify the automation of multiple tasks on NSX. If you prefer Ansible, there are also Ansible modules available in GitHub that can be used to create, read, update, or delete objects in NSX. And you can also use cloud management platforms like VMware vCloud Director or VMware vRealize Automation, as well as integrating NSX in OpenStack environments. Since we cannot cover all these automation possibilities in a reasonable amount of time, this video will focus on vRealize Automation and OpenStack. vRealize Automation is the engine of the VMware Cloud Management Suite. It is the portal where users consume items from the service catalog. It is where admins define and publish application templates that users will consume later, and also it takes care of all the governance an enterprise-grade cloud management platform requires. vRealize Automation retrieves information from other components of the suite to provide full visibility and context of what's going on in the cloud environment. In terms of operations, the suite analyzes both structured and unstructured data, so that users and admins are always informed about the health of their resources. In terms of cost management, the suite provides cost information about deployed services to both users and admins, and this information can be compared against the cost similar resources would have in other private environments or even in the private cloud. So this way, they can be deployed in the most convenient place. So VMware Cloud Suite not only provides agility for consuming IT resources, it also provides the visibility required to take informed decisions and optimize the use of those IT resources. vRealize Automation provides agility because it allows users to consume resources that have already been made available to them. The system teams exposes those machine types that have already been validated in the organization so that users can consume them. In this case, you can see how vRealize Automation can deploy in multiple environments, Amazon, OpenStack, Hyper-V, KVM, etc. Another team exposes the software components that can be consumed by users so that when they consume, for example, an Apache load balancer, they know they are using the version that has already been validated in the organization. And by integrating NSX, the same happens with the network and security. So the IP subnets that are consumed are those already validated by the network team, only that now they are automatically created following that specifications. And the security policies to be consumed are those that have already been validated by the security team. And then, combining all these components, a cloud admin builds an application template that will be consumed by the users. In this case, we see a three-tier application. There is a web tier, an app tier, and a database tier. There are multiple VMs on each tier. There are security policies between tier and inside each tier, so that we apply micro-segmentation even on the same VLAN. And there are also some advanced services like load balancers. All these components are automatically created and deployed when the user requests a new instance of the application, and this can happen once or multiple times. And the beauty here is that we are deploying resources that have already been validated by the organization in a very agile way, because we don't need to wait for specific teams to finish their own part of the process before the process continues, because it has been automated. From a user's perspective, all they need to do to get the application deployed is to click on the corresponding button offered on the service catalog. Because of the integration with NSX, what happens in the background is that the new networks are automatically created and connected to the distributed logical router. The VMs are also created and connected to these new networks as specified on the application template. And the security policies are also enforced as defined to ensure that VMs are protected from the very first moment they are instantiated. And finally, if there are advanced services like load balancing defined, they are also deployed. And this is how the application template or blueprint looks like in VMware vRealize Automation. So as you can see, it's a very intuitive and graphical user interface where you take objects on the left column, drag and drop them into the canvas, and they are connected in a very simple way. So you can consume NetRun security without being an expert because you are using components that have already been validated by the corresponding NetRun security teams. This concludes this introductory part to vRealize Automation. Let's move now into the demo, where we are going to see how to create this two-tier template. So here we have web servers that are connected to an on-demand created web network. We have app servers that are automatically connected to an on-demand created app network. We have an on-demand created web load balancer, and we are also applying on-demand security to both the web and app tiers. We start by logging into the tool as an administrator. And on the home screen we can see several information like resources consumed by the different business groups on the cloud platform, or the items that have already been deployed by the administrator, or even a calendar that shows the most significant events like services that have been deployed, when the next services expire, and all that kind of stuff. If we move to infrastructure and then select endpoints, and once again endpoints, we will find the vCenter registration, and we can edit it to see its details, and here we will find the reference to the NSX manager, which is the key to integrate the cloud tool with NSX. Next we go to infrastructure reservations and network profiles, and here we can see the different types of networks available to be consumed by the applications. So in this case we have external networks, which mean existing networks which could be based on VLAN or VXLAN. We also have NAT networks, which are those networks that are hidden behind a router which is doing NAT for the inside network. And also we have routed networks, which are networks created on demand using an IP address space that is routable inside the organization. Next we move to reservations, which are the pools of resources available to our cloud platform, and let's review the network details for our cluster. Here is where we map the network profiles we have seen before with the existing networks, and in the advanced settings section is where we introduce NSX specific details like the transport zone or the gateway to be used when creating on-demand routed networks. In this case, the NSX distributed logical router. Now we are seeing the catalog, which is where we expose the services that the users can consume. In this case, since we are using the administrator user, we have access to all services, but in a real environment, each user is presented only the services he or she is entitled to consume. Let's now move to the design tab to create our application blueprint, which is the template based on which the application is deployed on demand. We click on new, provide a descriptive name, in this case NSX Experience Day, and below we can define the archive and list policies we want this application to have. Next we move to the NSX settings, and here is where we link this blueprint with the NSX existing deployment. We hit OK, and then we are taken to the canvas, which is where we are going to build the blueprint of the application by simply dragging and dropping components that have already been exposed to the cloud tool. In this case we are using vSphere machines. We drag and drop one, we provide an ID, in this case it's going to be a web server. We can define a machine prefix. There are some available. We could have created a specific one if we wanted. And then we specify the minimum and maximum number of instances of this VM the user will be able to choose when deploying the application template. Next, we define how this VM is built. In this case, we are using a link clone to make it easier and faster. Then we select a CentOS template. And finally, we specify we are going to use a link agent. Under machine resources, we specify the CPU, memory and storage settings the user will be able to choose when requesting the application template. Under the storage tab, we can specify different settings of the disk of the VM. And both the network and security tabs show empty for now, but we will come back to them later. The properties tab also shows empty, but we are not using it during this demo. So we can go back to the canvas and we can see there is an error. So if we edit again the properties of the VM, we can see the error is on the ID, which does not allow blank spaces. So we are going to remove the blank space in the name and the error will disappear. Here we go. And now we can go back to the canvas. We drag and drop another vSphere machine. Because we are now creating a second tier for our application, which is the app tier. So we provided an ID. This time we leave no blank space in the middle. And we configure all other settings we have already seen for the web VM. For the sake of time, we are going to fast forward the video until we finish the app server configuration. Back to the canvas, we now move to the left side of the screen and under categories we select network and security, and here we are going to consume the network and security resources provided by NSX. We are going to use on-demand created networks, so we drag them on the left and drop them on the canvas. Next we select the network profile to consume, in this case the one using the NSX distributed logical router. We provide a descriptive name, in this case web network. And then some other settings are automatically completed based on the information on the network profile. The IP ranges tab shows the networks that are going to be consumed when creating on-demand networks. This can be integrated with your favorite IPAM tool, but in this case we don't have any on the lab, so we are using some kind of IPAM functionality provided by the tool itself. And we now repeat the operation to create a second on-demand network, which is the application network. So again, for the sake of time, we are going to fast forward the video. Now we are going to do something similar for the security. So we are going to use existing security groups. We drag and drop. And on the list, we select the one we are going to use. In this case, the demo web security group. Hit OK. And we repeat the same to create the app security group. Drag and drop. Select from the list the right group. In this case, demo app security group. And we go back to the canvas. Security groups are the way to make sure that VMs are protected by the right security policy. In this case, we are mapping VMs to existing security groups, but as you can see on the left side of the screen, there is also an option for on-demand security group creation. As we have network security and VMs on the canvas, we only need to start linking them. And for that, we edit the VM properties, we go to the network tab, we add a new interface, and we map it to the web network. We hit OK, and that's it, the IP will be automatically assigned. We go to the security tab, and we map the web VM to the web security group. And that's it. You can see on the screen that the links have already been added automatically by the tool. We repeat the process for the app VM. On the network we create one interface, we map it to the app network, which will be created on demand. The IP address will be assigned automatically. We link the VM to the app security group, and as you can see here we are missing one link. This is because I did something wrong on the network tab. Not only I need to create interface, I need to hit OK, which is something I forgot before. Now I hit OK and the link will appear. And we can also add some other network services like load balancers created on demand. We drag on the left, drop on the right, we give it a descriptive name, in this case web load balancer. We select the tier we are going to load balance, in this case web tier. For the web tier we select which NIC we are going to use for load balancing, and we also select on which network the VIP will reside. Finally, we select which services to load balance. Back to the canvas, we have a complete graphical view of our application. Two-tier application, web and app servers connected to on-demand networks, web and app networks using existing security groups, web and app security groups, and using an on-demand load balancer, the web load balancer. We click on Save for saving the blueprint, and on Finish to exit the canvas view. Next, we need to do some actions so that the blueprint appears on the catalog, because it's still on draft. So first we select the blueprint and we click on Publish. And then we need to work with the catalog administration. So for that we move to the Administration tab. Click on Catalog Items. We look for our blueprint on the list, select it, and click on Configure. Here we can assign an icon of our choice. In this case we are assigning a different NSX icon. And then on service, we are assigning the section of the catalog we want this blueprint to appear. In the example, we are assigning the blueprint to the section NSX. We click on OK. And then we move to the catalog to confirm that the blueprint has been published to the section we want it to be published. So it appears under the All Services tab, as expected also, as well as under the NSX tab, as you can see on the screen. There are many other governance things that can be done with the catalog, like assigning a specific day to operations depending on the user, or requesting approval flows depending on the user or the group the user belongs to, but they are out of the scope of this demo. For now, we will log out as the administrator user, and we will log back in as any cloud user with no administrative privileges. In this case, we are going to use the cloud user ID. We enter username and password, click on sign in, and we are directed to the home screen where we can see the open request, the items of this user ID, the calendar with the last request and expiration dates, recent request below, and some other interesting information. Under the items tab, we can see all the services this user is already managing because it has already deployed them. So far it only has an Apache load balancer under a native network. We go back to the catalog. Our blueprint appears under the All Services tab, as well as under the NSX tab. We click on Request. And here we are offered a form, which is highly configurable to make it easy and very intuitive for the customer to request the application. In this case, and for the sake of time, we are just using the default form, which allows us to select the list days for the app, as well as how many instances of this app we want to deploy. Then for the web servers tier, we can select how many web servers do we want, but we cannot select specifics on CPU, memory and storage because we didn't allow that on the blueprint. On the other side, for the app servers, we can select as well how many instances, but in this case we can edit the memory we want because we allowed for that on the blueprint. Once we are ready, we hit on submit, and that's all we need to do to request the application. Next we move to the Requests tab. You can see the history of the services we have already requested. So you can see we have done several tests within NSX Experience Day Blueprint. Some of them have failed, but for now we will focus on 993, which is the one we have just submitted. So we select it and click on View Details. And we are taken to another window where we are going to select on the top right corner Execution Details. So we click on Refresh. And here we can see the list of actions the tool takes to deploy the application. The first one on the list are related to allocation of resources, and we can see that each time we click on refresh, some of them are marked as successful. And for the sake of time, we are going to fast forward the video until all allocation steps are completed. Once allocation steps are done, next, the tool focuses on the network and security settings. So we can see it's trying to deploy security groups and networks. Security groups are easily done because they already exist. But the tool keeps deploying the new networks created on demand. If we go to the NSX console, under the logical switches tab, we can see there are two new networks, an app network on top and a web network on the bottom, which have been automatically created on demand as part of the request of the application. Back to the automation tool, we hit on refresh and we can see that the networks have been successfully deployed. Next, the tool is deploying the NSX edge, which will be the load balancer created on demand. If on the NSX console we move to the NSX edge tab, we can see a newly created edge, which is related to the NSX Experience Day blueprint, which will be our load balancer created on demand. Also, if we check the configuration of the distributed logical router, we refresh the GUI and we can see there are two new interfaces with their IP addresses, which are the ones corresponding to the networks that have been created on demand by the tool. This is because we are using a network profile that uses routed networks, meaning that these networks will be reachable inside the organization. Back to vRealize Automation GUI, we can see the deployment of the NSX edge is in progress. If we click refresh, there is no new updates. So let's go back to NSX and see what's going on with this NSX edge. So here we go, it's the NSX edge tab again. We double click on the edge and here we can see there is one single IP address configured, and under the load balancing settings we can see there are no virtual servers. Actually, load balancing is disabled. There are no application profiles. We are not using any service monitoring setting. There are no server pools. So let's go back to the vRealize Automation GUI and see how the deployment progresses. We click on refresh again and now we can see the NSX edge is marked as successfully deployed, but the web load balancer is still waiting. This is because the vRealize Automation tool is now deploying the VMs, and until we know the IP addresses for those VMs, the load balancing configuration cannot be finalized. Let's go now to vCenter to check the list of the existing VMs. We can see there is quite a long list, but there are no app or web VM, even if we refresh the GUI to get the most current information. So let's now jump back to vRealize Automation. We click on refresh, there are still no significant news here. So let's go back to vCenter and see what's going on there. We click on refresh again, there's still the list of VMs is the same, no news. We hit refresh once more and now we will see three new VMs appearing. We can see two web VMs on the bottom of the list, Web24 and Web25, plus one app VM on top, app 18. All of them are still power off because the deployment process has not yet finalized. So let's go back to vRealize Automation, click again on refresh. Deployment is still in progress, has not finished yet for the VMs. Back to vCenter, we click on refresh and we will keep swapping between these two tasks until there are significant news to see what they are and analyze them. And I will fast forward the video until then for the sake of time. We can see there has been a change and our new VMs are now powered on as part of the deployment process, and even they have been connected to the networks created on demand, as it can be seen on the screen. Back to vRealize Automation, we click again on refresh and we can see there are no news here because from a deployment perspective the VMs are still in progress. So we will fast forward the video once more until there are significant changes. Now we can see vRealize Automation has marked the web VMs as deployed, and even we can see the name assigned to those VMs, and if we hit refresh again we can see the app VM has finished as well. The name of the VMs is the same we have seen earlier, app 18, web24 and web25, but let's go back to vCenter and double check it. Here we go, app 18 on top, web24 and web25 on the bottom. So the only task pending is the configuration of the load balancer. So let's hit refresh on NSX and let's look at the load balancing configuration. Still load balancing is disabled, but we can see that now an application profile exists, which was not here before. It's for load balancing HTTP. If we hit refresh again, now it's been added HTTPS, so the configuration is going at this very same moment. Under the pools section there are two pools, one for port 80 and the other one for port 443, even when both are using the same VMs, the web servers. And under virtual servers configuration is similar, there are two entries because the same IP address is listening on both port 80 and port 443. Back to global configuration, we can see that finally load balancing has been enabled. If we move back to Realize Automation, we can see that now the deployment has been successfully finished. And if we click on OK, we can see the global status of successful for this request. But we still need to check what security has been applied to this application. So let's go back to NSX, to the Service Composer tab, and let's see the security groups here. So here we have the Web and App Security group we use when defining the blueprint, and we can see our App VM belongs to the App Security group, and the two Web VMs belong to the Web Security group as expected and as we defined on the blueprint. If we move to the Firewall tab of NSX, there are a few pre-configured security rules which we are using in this lab, some of them leveraging the app and web security groups we are using to protect our application. This means that from the very first moment the VMs are deployed, they are protected with the security policies our security team has defined for them. And with vRealize Automation and NSX, it is also possible to have security policies created on demand at deployment time, which is very interesting for many use cases. And this concludes the demo of the integration of NSX with the VMware Cloud Management Platform. Let's now move to OpenStack. So what is OpenStack? It is an open source framework that provides vendor-neutral APIs to consume pools of compute, storage, and networking inside a data center. Aside from the open source versions, there are vendor-specific distributions, each one supported and validated against a limited set of versions and products. And of course, to get the vendor support, you typically have to pay a recurrent fee. VMware is deeply committed to OpenStack and actually is one of the top 10 contributors by the number of developers, commits, line of code, and patches reviewed. Not only that, but also VMware works openly with the OpenStack vendor ecosystem to ensure technologies like vSphere, NSX, or vRealize Automation, or even vRealize Operations work with third-party distributions. Actually, you can find on the internet reference architectures and deployment guides by vendors like Canonical, Mirantis, or even Red Hat. Aside from this, VMware has its own OpenStack distribution, which is called VIO, VMware Integrated OpenStack, and is fully compliant with the OpenStack specifications, and is available for free for all VMware Enterprise Plus customers. It is based on robust and very well-known VMware products like vSphere for compute, NSX for network and security, or vSAN for storage, plus some operations and visibility tools like LogInsight or vRealize Operations. The key value is that it provides a robust, enterprise-grade OpenStack cloud tested and supported by VMware, which is very easy to manage because it uses familiar technologies and tools underneath. It is very easy to operate and troubleshoot because it also has support for all VMware operations stack, and it's very, very easy to upgrade and keep updated because it's delivered as a virtual appliance. But don't just believe VMware. Listen by yourself what customers like Adobe, Nike, or Wells Fargo have to say about VMware and OpenStack. Let's now move to the demo of NSX and all other VMware components with OpenStack. So let's log into the Ryzen portal with administrator credentials. And here we will move into Project, Network, and network topology. We can see there is an external network as well as an existing testnet network. If we click on it, we can see its ID. It starts with 8571E, and let's go to NSX to check that the ID is exactly the same of this existing NSX logical switch. Back to Horizon, we create a new network, we give it a descriptive name, actually with a typo, we create a new subnet, provide the IP address for this subnet, hit on next, and enable DHCP, and that's it. And the network is created from the OpenStack Horizon portal. So if we click in our web tier network, we see its ID, and we go back to NSX, we refresh the GUI, and we can see a new network has appeared, and the ID is exactly the same as our recently created web tier from OpenStack. Let's go back to network topology and the new web tier appears on the map. Now in NSX, under the NSX Edges tab, we can see there is one DHCP router plus four backup routers. Let's go to Horizon, create a new router, we give it a name, logical router. And here we go, we have our new router created. Back to NSX, we refresh the GUI and we can see the bottommost router has been renamed to logical router. We edit it, and we can see there is one external interface with no IP address assigned. So we will go back to Horizon to assign an IP address to this router. So for that, we go to the router section. Under the logical router, we click on set gateway. We assign it to the external network. And that's it. It will be automatically assigned an IP address. Back to NSX, we click on refresh, and here we go. This is the IP address we have just configured. Back to Horizon, we can see that the network topology now shows the router connected to the external network. So let's go back to routers. We click on our logical router, select it, and we'll add a new interface. So for that, we map it to the web tier we created before, and that's it. The new interface is automatically created and assigned an IP address from the subnet we configured before. Back to NSX, we hit again on refresh, and we can see a new interface appears in our router using the same IP address we have just seen in Horizon, as expected. And on the network topology, we can see the router has two interfaces, one to the external network and a new one to the web tier. So let's now repeat the process and create a new network, the database tier. So we give it a descriptive name. We assign it a new IP subnet, in this case 20.0.0.0/24, and click on next, enable DHCP, and that's it. The new network appears in Horizon, and if we edit it, we can see its ID, and if we go back to NSX, to the logical switches tab, we can see a new switch has appeared on top, with the same ID as the one we have just seen in Horizon. And actually, if we check the network topology again, we can see as it shows up here too. So let's now go and edit our router to create a new interface connecting to this database tier. But before, let's go back to NSX to check that our logical router still has only two interfaces, the ones we have seen before. So now, we are ready to create the new interface. We assign it to the database tier, and the interface is created with an IP address assigned from the subnet we defined it earlier. So back to NSX, we refresh the GUI, and we can see there is a new interface in our router, the 20.0.0.1. And on the network topology, the router now shows connected also to the database tier. Once the network is done, let's move to compute and instances to deploy new VMs and check connectivity. So we launch a new instance, we give it a descriptive name, in this case web instance 01. We select the flavor or the size. We also select how many instances we want to be created on this request and how they will be created, in this case using a Debian image. On the networking tab, we assign to which network we want the interface of this VM to be connected, in this case web tier, and we click on launch so that the deployment of our two VMs starts. We are going to launch a new instance, which will be our database VM, so we give it the corresponding name. Again, select the flavor. In this case we are going to deploy one single instance, and we will use the same Debian image we use for the web VMs. On the networking tab, we now assign the interface to the database network we created before. We click on launch and deployment starts. So we can check the progress. And if we move to the network topology map, we can see the VMs connected to the corresponding networks, two web tiers and one database tier VM. Let's go back to the compute instances section. Here we can see the progress of our deployment. We can see the three VMs have assigned an IP address, one on the database subnet and two on the web subnet, and we can launch the console for the database VM. So we can see it's still starting up. And in the meanwhile, we increase the size of the screen so that we can see it better. In a few seconds, we will get the login. Here we go. So we log in with root and the password. And this is our database VM. So we check its IP address and we can see it's from the database subnet. And we try a ping to both web servers. It works. And then we try another ping to both gateways, one for the web subnet and another one for the database subnet. And both work. As expected, everything works fine because we haven't introduced any security rule. On the instances tab, we can confirm the IP addresses we were using, and on the network topology, we can see we have two VMs connected to the web tier and one database VM connected to the database tier. If we go back to NSX, to the logical switches tab, and we double click on the database switch, we can see it's connected to two VMs, which are the router and the database VM. If we repeat for the web logical switch, double click on it, and we can see it has three VMs connected, the router plus the two web VMs. So the networking requests we have issued from the Horizon OpenStack portal are automatically translated into NSX. The same happens with security groups, which we won't cover on this demo since there are already very good resources available on the internet. And this way we finish the content for this video. We have seen how VMware provides a comprehensive, easy-to-use, enterprise-grade automation platform that delivers agility and security with cost visibility and simplified operations with 100% compliant OpenStack integration. Again, thanks for watching, I hope you have enjoyed the demo, and please check my YouTube channel where this and all other videos of this series will be uploaded. Thank you!